So, it's time for the next afternoon session. So the next speaker will be Dr. Frank Werner from Göttingen. So he got his PhD thesis at the University of Göttingen some years ago, and now he's joined with the Max Planck Institute in Göttingen, and of course with still with strong connections to the University of Göttingen. And so he will speak about the unbiased risk estimation as parameter choice rule for filter-based regularization methods. So, go ahead.
Thank you very much for the introduction. Also, thanks a lot to the organizers for this nice workshop and for giving me the opportunity to speak here. I must admit that this is mostly a theoretical talk. Hopefully, it will still be of interest for many of you. And I also emphasize that it's joint work with Hausen Li, who's with the National University of Defense Technology in China. Yeah, here's a short outline of the talk. First, I would like to give an introduction about the problem. So I would like to fix the notation. And then I would like to discuss some a posteriori parameter choice methods. Especially, I will focus on four, and then I will provide an error analysis for this based on unbiased risk estimation here in the third part. Then I will show you some simulations and end with a conclusion. So the overall problem statement is like this. I would like to consider a statistical inverse problem. So this means that I have two Hilbert spaces, X and Y, and a bounded linear operator mapping X into Y. And I would like to recover an unknown element F in X from noisy measurements of this form. So Y is TF plus sigma xi. And why is this a statistical inverse problem? Well, the xi should be a standard Gaussian white noise process here. And sigma is the noise level. So on first glance, one might argue that this is written in a little bit slanty way, because if xi is Gaussian white noise, then this element here is not in the same space as TF. So this one lives in the Hilbert space Y, but this one actually lives in the dual space. So this kind of model should be understood in a weak sense, meaning that for each g in the Hilbert space Y, I can observe a random variable yg, which is of this form here. And now the randomness is completely included in this part here. And for each g, this one is a normal random variable with mean zero and norm given and variance given by the norm of g squared. And the covariance structure is like this. And this is basically one special point about statistical inverse problems. The noise I observe is not in the same space as my exact data, which makes life more difficult. Okay. So in the following, I will assume that this T is injective to avoid some problems, and I will assume that it's a Hilbert-Schmidt operator. So if I denote the singular values by sigma k, it means that they are square summable. And I will also assume that the noise level sigma, not to be confused with the sigma k here, yeah, is known exactly. And if this is the case, then I can go to filter-based regularization schemes, which you might all know. So for a filter function q alpha, I consider estimators f alpha hat of the truth given by q alpha t star t times t star y. And this is well defined because as t is Hilbert-Schmidt, this one here really gives an element in the correct space in x, and everything is fine. So, and this is all I would like to focus on in the following. There's one question remaining. What is the alpha? How do I choose the alpha? And this is exactly the topic of this talk. I would like to find a data-driven rule, so-called a posteriori choice rule of alpha, such that as my noise level sigma tends to zero, I still get the optimal rate of convergence. I do not lose anything by adaptation, so by choosing the alpha only data dependent. And for experts, I'd like to note here that I can also consider heuristic parameter choice here. So one might argue that the Bakushinsky veto tells it's not possible, but it does not apply here. Yeah? According to this paper by Becker from 2011, in the setting I consider here, where the noise process does not change as sigma tends to zero, the Bakushinsky veto does not hold. So there are heuristic parameter choice rules, which do not need to know the noise level sigma, which still converge, just as a side remark here. Okay, so now I would like to discuss some known a posteriori parameter choice methods, and one which I would like to put more emphasis on today. And let's start with the most best known one, the discrepancy principle. If my data was deterministic, then it's defined as the largest possible alpha for which the residuum falls below a tuning parameter tau times the noise level. So whenever I can explain my data at least as good as tau times the noise level, then I stop. So this should be the largest alpha for which this holds. But unfortunately, I cannot write it like this here. As I told you, the noise is not in the correct space. So y is not in the correct space. So I cannot write this down. This will be infinity with probability 1 in my stochastic noise model. And therefore, I have to do something. So either I can pre-smooth, which means that I replace my equation by applying t star on first glance. So then I get new data z, which is t star y. And this is then given as t star t f plus sigma t star xi. And due to the Hilbert-Schmidt property, this is in the correct space. Then I can write everything down. Or I have to go to a discretized version of the data. So if I project onto an n-dimensional space, then I get a data vector, which is an Rn. And the noise, if I do this in the correct way, just reduces to an n-dimensional normal random variable with covariance structure, which is given by the identity matrix. So then everything is well defined. And I can replace this continuous definition here, because now everything is in the correct space, by this discretized condition here, where I have to put a square root of n here. This is just the expectation of the norm of my noise vector squared. This is well defined, and with this one I can work. And actually, for these things here, there is a recent paper where some results are shown. Actually, it's this one by Blanchard, Hoffman, and Reis. And just to discuss briefly some pros and cons of this discrepancy principle, so it's very easy to implement. It works basically for all choices of filters I can consider here. And it gives order optimal convergence rates, as for example shown in this paper here in the statistics setting. But there are some drawbacks. So first of all, I have to choose a tuning parameter tau here, and there is no general understanding how one should choose it. In my statistical setting, I can make it meaningful only in a discretized way, which means that in my analysis, I also have to take into account the discretization artifacts. And one thing which is also known for the discrepancy principle, one has early saturation, which means that depending on the filter, one does get the optimal convergence rates only up to a certain threshold, and from then on, one is suboptimal. Okay. A second possibility is the quasi-optimality criterion, which might also be known to many of you. Neubauer in 2008 gave this general definition of it. So if I denote by r alpha the function which is given by 1 minus lambda times q alpha of lambda, then the alpha according to the quasi-optimality principle is just the minimizer of this norm of this element here. This is a very nice and general definition, but it has some drawbacks because if, for example, I consider spectral cutoff, one can readily compute that this term here vanishes for all alpha, which means that the definition is not meaningful. Yeah? Nevertheless, for some other methods, for example, for Tichonoff regularization, one can write down a finite difference scheme. So if one has m candidates of alpha values, alpha 1 to alpha m, then this just reduces to kind of finite differences between the estimators. So I can make this definition, I can make an asymptotically equivalent definition by considering the differences and then minimize these differences over n. Yeah, again, a short discussion of pros and cons. So again, you can see that it's very easy to implement, and it's also very fast because you just need to compute these differences here. This is kind of m differences of vectors in x, and then you have to minimize over the norm of those. It's very simple. You do not need to know sigma, so actually it's a heuristic parameter choice rule, and this makes it also very stable if the noise level is misspecified. And it can also be shown that under certain conditions, you get order optimal convergence rates, at least in mildly ill-posed situations, if the spectral values, the singular values do not decay too fast. But as I've outlined here, you need some special structure of the Q alpha. You need some smoothness, because otherwise the definition is not meaningful, or you have to kind of make it meaningful by redefining the principle. I also said that you need additional assumptions on noise. In my setting here, everything is satisfied, but in general, things can go wrong. And it's unclear how this criterion performs in severely ill-posed situations. So the third a posterior parameter choice rule, which I would like to discuss here, is the Lepsky type balancing principle. And with a simple computation, one can find out that the standard deviation of this estimator f alpha hat here can be bounded by sigma times the square root of the trace of this operator. Yeah, so this is why I denoted it by standard of alpha. And now the Lepsky principle works as follows. So if you are given m candidates for alpha, you choose the Lepsky index as the maximal j for which the pairwise differences up to j are bounded by 4 times kappa. Kappa is again a tuning parameter times the standard deviation of alpha k. And then the corresponding alpha to the Lepsky principle is just the nth alpha. It might seem strange on first glance why one has to consider these pairwise differences up to j here, but there are very nice motivations for this principle, which I would not like to go into detail here. Again, this is a method which works for all choices of q alpha, basically. So there is no trouble if it's spectral cutoff or whatever. No smoothness is required. Even though this seems a little strange on first glance, it turns out that this principle is very robust in practice. Yeah, it works quite well. And one also has a clear statement that one gets convergence rates in mildly as well as in severely ill-posed problems. One drawback is that it's computationally really expensive because to compute the standard deviation, I have to compute traces of these operators here, which is numerically expensive. Again, I have a tuning parameter kappa, which I have to choose in a correct way to get convergence rates, depending on the decay of the singular values. And the convergence rates are only close to order optimal. One loses a log factor compared to the optimal rate. Okay. And now I come to the unbiased drift estimation I mentioned in my title. And there I would like to do the following. So basically, the idea could be that my optimal alpha minimizes the norm of the residuum. And, well, the residuum cannot be implemented directly because TF is unknown, and therefore I'd like to estimate it from the data. So dating back to ideas of Mellows and Stein in 81, I define this functional here. So basically it looks a bit like a Tychonoff functional. So if I would add norm y squared here, this would exactly be the residuum. And then I add a 2 sigma trace of this operator. And then I define my corresponding alpha as the minimizer of this functional. So what is the rationale behind? It turns out that the expectation of this functional, pointwise, is just the expectation of this residuum. And this residuum is what I would like to minimize, minus a constant which is independent of alpha. So this is why I would like to call this method unbiased risk estimation. I estimate the risk in an unbiased way and minimize my estimator. Yeah, so what is known about this principle? So there is a quite recent paper that if I use spectral cutoff, and if the problem is mildly ill-posed, then I get an optimal rate of convergence. But besides this, nearly nothing is known what would be interesting for inverse problems. So in statistics, for example, there is a vast literature about optimality in image space, so about optimal convergence of this risk here, but it's not informative in inverse problems because of the t inside. I'm interested of the rate of convergence of f alpha hat minus f, and not of t f alpha hat minus tf. Yeah, and this is why I would now like to discuss what happens, does this principle work, what are pros and cons, do I get convergence rates, and do I get order optimality? And therefore, I have to go into the error analysis of these statistical inverse problems and of this special parameter choice, and therefore I have to pose kind of first of all the standard assumptions one has in deterministic regularization theory. So I need to assume that my Q alpha is a filter, which are these two things here. I have to assume that there holds a certain source condition. So I will consider sets W phi, which consist of all functions which satisfy this spectral source condition here with index function phi. And it's known that for any f, there exists a phi such that I'm in such a space. So basically, I just restrict to subsets of certain smoothness. And finally, I also need to assume that this function phi from the source condition is a qualification of the filter, which basically tells me that I get optimal convergence rates at least up to phi. So, and if this is true, then I have to put some additional assumptions because I'm working with the statistical inverse problem, there it turns out that basically the variance of my estimator depends on the decay rate of the singular values, and therefore I define this sigma here. It just counts how many singular values are larger than square root of x. So this is a function which increases, which decreases, and especially this function has discontinuities whenever x equals a singular value. And to overcome these problems, I would like to assume that I can approximate it by a smooth function. So I assume that there is some s, which is C2, and it basically approximates this function in a nice way. So the first one is basically the approximation property. Close to zero, they behave the same way. I have this decreasing behavior. If alpha tends to infinity, so then this function won't change anymore, and also its derivative will not change anymore. So I assume these two things. And as my operator is Hilbert-Schmidt, also this one should hold true. So this is kind of just ensuring that the S really approximates the correct thing. And additionally, I have to post some integrability conditions and a boundedness condition. So this assumption is not from myself. Basically, it's from this paper by Bissans, Hoage, Munk, and Rühmgard, who were the first to analyze statistical inverse problems this way by filter-based methods. And if these assumptions hold true, then one can choose alpha such that this equation holds true. This is basically the optimal alpha, and one obtains rates of this form. So uniformly over my source set, the mean integrated square error is bounded by this quantity, and if additionally a stronger qualification assumption is satisfied, then I get for the residuum in image space this rate of convergence. So this is the a priori convergence rate, but I would like to talk about my unbiased Grist estimation rate. And just to get something more concrete, I would like to put this one in a specific setting. So suppose we are in a mildly ill-posed situation and have a source condition of this form. So this is a Sobolev ellipsoid. And then everything can be given exactly in the exponents can be made precise in A and B. And these are then known to be the optimal rates of convergence over these Sobolev ellipsoids. I'm sorry, this one should be in B here. Okay, so and in this case, the a priori rates I've shown on the slide before are optimal, and now I would like to obtain the same rates for my unbiased Grist estimation principle. So just to recall it, it was defined by this functional here, and then as the minimizer of this functional, and to get kind of something concrete out of it, I would like to compute or to compare the parameter I get by minimizing this estimator with the parameter I would get by minimizing the exact quantity, which I do not have at hand. I cannot do this in practice because I do not know f. But I would like to compare the behavior. And there's another slide of assumptions that I have to pose to do this. I need the assumption that this mapping alpha to q alpha evaluated at the singular value squared is strictly monotone and continuous. I need some bound from below for alpha, q alpha of alpha, and I need to assume that this function lambda, q alpha of lambda, is non-decreasing. So basically, these three assumptions are not bad for all methods one typically uses in practice, like Tichonov, spectral cutoff, Landweber, and so on. They are satisfied if the parameterization is chosen correctly. So consider, for example, Tichonov regularization. If I reparameterize alpha by square root of alpha, then the q alpha would look like 1 over square root of alpha plus lambda, and this does not satisfy this one here anymore. So basically, it's only a parameterization condition. It's not a condition which is bad for the filter. Yeah. And then I have to assume that my phi function from the source condition is such that this transformed function psi here is convex. This is also quite well known from the analysis in inverse problems. And I have some integrability condition, which basically tells me that my singular values do not decay too fast or too slow. Yeah, let me mention that this d here, for example, can always be satisfied by just enlarging the space of the source space a little bit. Okay. And if this is satisfied, then I can prove an oracle inequality, which now tells me that the risk which I get in pre-image space under my parameter choice based on unbiased risk estimation, this risk can be bounded from above by something. It looks quite weird, but it only depends on the risk in image space when I evaluate it at the optimal alpha. Yeah. So again, on this slide, I have defined the optimal alpha as the minimizer of this risk function in image space here. And now I get an Oracle inequality, which tells me that in pre-image space, I behave like something which depends only on the optimal risk in image space. So it gives me a comparison of the strong risk with the weak risk under the Oracle. And if now I would like to compute this optimal risk in image space here, and this can be done by the a priori choice I've shown you before. So if I have a stronger qualification condition, then my risk is uniformly bounded like this one here. And just to note, so this one was the optimal rate I've shown you in the a priori setting. And here I have something which comes in additionally, and it looks pretty much like it, but there is some constant inside, and I cannot be sure that I can pull it out. So if I can pull out this constant, then I get the a priori rate, which was optimal in certain settings. And this is only due to this Oracle inequality, which gave me a comparison of the risk I would like to analyze here with the optimal risk in image space. And I can now make this precise in multi-ILPOS problems. Well, there it's not surprising that I can pull out this constant. And if I make everything precise, the Oracle inequality looks like this. So it's a power of the best possible risk in image space plus something which is weighted with powers of the noise level and powers of the best possible risk in image space. And this leads to the conclusion that if I have a stronger qualification condition, I get the order optimal convergence rate. It's not surprising that I need a plus 1/2 here in the qualification condition because my method is based on the residual, like the discrepancy principle, and the discrepancy principle also needs this plus 1/2 in the qualification condition. Okay. So let me conclude what I've shown you so far. Basically, I now have an analysis of this method, which tells me that my method works for many Q alpha, not for all, but for many, and especially for all, for the most often used ones. I get order optimal convergence rates in multi-ILPOS situations. I do not lose a log factor, and I have no tuning parameter. But again, this is computationally expensive because, like in Lepsky's principle, I have to compute all these traces here. I have the same early saturation phenomenon as I have for the discrepancy principle, and so far it's unclear how it performs in severely ILPOS situations, because in severely ILPOS situations, I cannot pull out this constant out of the s to the minus 1. And therefore, I'd like to come now to the simulation section, where I would like to see how it performs in practice, and especially in exponentially or severely ILPOS situations. But let's start with a simpler example here. So I consider a mildly ILPOS situation. This is the second antiderivative. So t is just defined as this integral operator here, and as this minimum I've written here is just Green's function. It turns out that tf double prime is just minus f. And from this equation, I can readily see how the singular values of t must behave. They behave like sigma k is k to the minus 2. So the problem is mildly ill-posed. And if I choose my unknown solution to be this head function here, then I can compute the Fourier coefficients and find out what the optimal rate of convergence is. And it turns out it's O of sigma to the 3 over 4 minus epsilon for any arbitrarily small epsilon. With my spectral force condition, I cannot get rid of this minus epsilon, therefore I have to use other spaces, but this is not what I would like to discuss here. So in the following, I will always consider sigma to the 3 over 4 as the optimal rate of convergence. And yeah, this is what the simulations give. So I've chosen Tychonoff regularization here. In all what follows, I choose Tychonoff regularization, but I've also done these simulations for Showalter and spectral cutoff and so on. Things do not change much. And what is depicted here on the left, there is the empirical mean integrated square error. And on the right, you can see the variance. And I have compared all parameter choice rules we have discussed here. So in blue, you see the Oracle choice, which is not possible in practice. But as I know the unknown solution here, it's fine. The discrepancy principle in purple. Then in light green, there is this quasi-optimality rule. In red, the Lepsky principle, and in green, my method based on unbiased risk estimation. And all these empirical MSE invariants have been computed from 10 to the 4 repetitions for each noise level. And you see, as sigma decreases, all methods seem to get the optimal rate of convergence, even though the quasi-optimality does something strange initially. And for the variance, it also seems that they all decrease at the same rate. but the method based on unbiased risk estimation has a slightly higher variance for all noise levels. So now let's go to a more severely ill posed situation, satellite gradiometry. So if I would work in dimension 3, then that would be exactly satellite gradiometry, but for computational purposes, I consider d equal 2 here. So basically, I would like to identify the boundary condition f in this PDE from measurements of the second derivative of g on a larger sphere. And yeah, this operator can be expanded in a series expansion, for example, based on yeah, here it's Fourier functions. In 3D, it would be spherical harmonics, and it turns out that the singular values are exactly like this. So they decay exponentially with the rate r to the minus absolute value of k minus 2. So the problem is really severely ill-posed, and my unknown solution is again a head function, but now this head has to be on minus pi to pi, because this is a natural parametrization of the one sphere. And with these two things, I can compute the optimal rate of convergence. It's logarithmic in sigma. It's minus log of sigma to the power of minus 3, again with this plus epsilon, which is because I work with vector source conditions. So the simulations, so the results look should look, well, what you see is the same as you have seen on two slides before, but now the problem is different. Again, it's Tichonoff regularization, and the rate of convergence is again depicted by this black line here. And it seems, again, that all parameter choice methods give the optimal rate of convergence, but the variance behaves kind of strange because it decreases for all but the method based on unbiased risk estimation. And now I thought, why could this be? Why should the variance of this method not decay? And the problem is that the method based on unbiased risk estimation, it's kind of based on something which should hold an expectation. Yeah? I would like to minimize a functional, which I do not have at hand. So I estimate it by something, and in expectation, everything is fine. But for every single instance, these two functionals can be completely different. And this means that the minimizers can be completely different. And this explains why the method has an intrinsically higher variance, which does not seem to decrease as the noise level tends to zero. That does not mean that I do not get the optimal rate of convergence. That's not clear. But it's a little bit strange that I do not concentrate around my mean, basically. And now, a third example, I consider the backwards heat equation. This is basically identifying the initial condition f in this PDE here from measurements of the state at some time point t bar. This is also exponentially ill-posed. Basically, it can be shown that the singular values behave like e to the minus k squared. So it's even more ill-posed than the satellite gradiometry problem. And I choose the same head function as my unknown solution. And with this, I can compute that the optimal rate of convergence is now minus log of sigma to the minus 3 over 2 plus any small arbitrary epsilon. So again, the results. The means seem to be okay for all parameter choice methods. The variances behave kind of strange, and this is because the singular values of this method decay so fast. But still, it seems that the variance for unbiased risk estimation is too large, or it does not decrease to zero as sigma tends to zero. Okay. So now I have convinced at least myself that most of these parameter choice methods, if not all, give optimal rates of convergence also in exponentially ill-posed problems, but this is not everything I can ask for. I would also like to understand how good are they compared to the best possible parameter choice rule, the oracle. So I would like to measure the efficiency of a parameter choice rule alpha star by this fraction here. So typically, the oracle alpha O will be better than any other parameter choice rule because it takes the best possible alpha, and so this fraction will always be smaller than 1, but the closer it is to 1, the better this parameter choice rule alpha star here is in practice. And therefore, I would like to simulate these ratios here in the following example. So I consider a problem where my singular values decay like e to the minus ak. So the ill-posedness is a little bit like in the satellite gradiometry problem. My unknown solution has a certain smoothness, k to the minus nu, and now the sign and this fluctuation around the decay is chosen randomly, and my data is just simulated from a diagonal matrix, so sigma k times fk plus Gaussian normal, Gaussian random noise, and I do this for 300 times 300 matrices, and now I for every fixed noise level sigma, I repeat 10 to the 4 times, and therefore I get empirical versions of this fraction here. And again, I use Tichonov regularization. Again, I use different regularization approaches here, but the simulations, the results do not change much. As I said, the closer this ratio is to 1, the better the parameter choice rule is. So, and again, now I cannot depict the oracle anymore because the oracle would be 1 everywhere, but in this bluish-green here, you see the quasi-optimality principle, in purple, the discrepancy principle, in red, the Lepsky principle, and in green, this unbiased Grist estimation thing. And now we should compare them. The closer they are to 1, the better they are for different parameters of ill-postness and smoothness. And here it seems that everything is fine. Yeah? So as sigma approaches 0, they all seem to be stable below, above, say, 0.7 or 0.8. So it seems that they behave up to a constant as good as the oracle. Now, if I increase the ill-postness, it seems pretty much the same. Unbiased Grist estimation becomes a bit worse, but it's not too bad. I increase the ill-postness furthermore, and things do not change too much. But what has a big effect here is the smoothness of my unknown solution. So if I now consider plots where the ill-postness is again 0.3, but the smoothness increases, then it seems that something goes wrong for this unbiased Grist estimation. The constant, which I get compared to the oracle, deteriorates as sigma tends to 0. And if I compare the others, just on a brief view, it always seems that the quasi-optimality principle is the best one. It's always closest to 1 all the time in all my experiments. Okay. And therefore, now I'd like to come to my conclusion. So first of all, I've shown you an analysis of a parameter choice based on this unbiased Grist estimation. So I've shown you an oracle optimality, which compares the strong risk under my alpha ur with the optimal risk in image space, which leads to convergence rates under certain assumptions, and especially to order optimality in mildly ill-posed situations. And furthermore, I've shown you a numerical comparison where it seems that in the setting I've considered here, for sure it's somehow special, but still I would like to draw the conclusion that in this situation, quasi-optimality outperforms all other methods, and it also seems that unbiased Grist estimation has a higher variance by design. Yeah? This is due to the definition of this method. And the simulations suggest that quasi-optimality is also order optimal in severely ill-posed problems, which is not known analytically so far, but it seems like this from my numerical comparison. But it's not clear if this is true for unbiased Grist estimation here. And if one goes into the statistical literature, it seems that one has to kind of change the design slightly to overcome this problem with the higher variance. And therefore, I'd like to thank you for your attention.